Hey guys, it's Amy and Ben. We're here to discuss episode 3 of The Mandalorian, titled The Sin. This is a TV series I can get absolutely on board with.
Yep, I agree. I think this was the, I don't know if breakout episode's the right one, but this was the one that legitimized or kind of, you know, staked its claim in terms of the quality of the series. You know, in terms of a bit of background on how we've thought and reviewed episodes previously on this one, we thought that they were good, that they had some areas for improvement. We felt the Disney aspect to them a lot as well. This episode, though, this is what we were hoping for.
Yeah, and it's taking on more of the stuff that works for Disney and then actually being a little bit serious in parts.
Yeah.
So what works for Disney is obviously the cutesy aspect of Baby Yoda.
Yep.
I really like that. And I think the music is definitely coming to the fore a lot more than
the music has stepped up, yeah.
Yeah, well, it's not stepped up. It's more that we're actually, like, seeing more of it. I actually look back on it and I enjoyed the drums in the first episode, but I know you thought it was a little bit cheesy.
No, it wasn't the drums that I thought was cheesy. It was the hero music during the battles that I found was cheesy. Sure. And so what I thought was really good in this one is that we didn't get that. We got a lot more of a serious tone to all of this. And so if I kind of start going through the things that I liked about the episode. So one, I think that was good, was that we learned a bit more about the Mandalorian culture and the underground aspect of it at the moment. So I thought that was really good.
So did I.
Particularly that we learned that, you know, they don't take off their helmets. We learned more about, you know, that it was the Empire that put them in this position, that there was kind of like an enclave that was hidden. And that also around, let's just say, you know, the brother and sisterhood of it. And so, you know, they are all like one people, one culture and things like that. And they need to be supportive. And that kind of comes out towards the end of the episode.
I definitely felt the Spartan element of that. I know we were talking about what it felt like. It definitely felt like a Spartan society where they sort of stick together to raise their foundlings.
Yep.
And that they've got a code that they need to stick to, the Mandalore, which is great as well because one, it means like law, but also it's kind of sounds like law. So it's really great in that aspect as well. So it's just good for me because I'm not naturally a Star Wars fan. And so I've never been introduced to the Mandalorian, but automatically I'm getting an understanding of what they are.
Yeah.
And I'm also getting an understanding of who Din is. So I think Din is actually the name of Pedro Pascal's character. And I'm getting an understanding of what he is purporting to achieve with the code that he's chosen to follow, and also the differences that he's starting to feel possibly from that sense of honor inside that may mean that he has to go against the code in order to stay true to himself. And I think it's interesting, his relationship with Yoda is so well built on, but I also really enjoy the humor elements of his character and how real he is. It's really hard, I think, for someone who is behind a helmet the entire time and has very solid armor on to show what they're feeling through their body language and through their voice. But I think he's doing a really great job. And I think that's also up to the directors of the episodes and the writing.
Yeah.
There's a couple of things that I wanted to call out on, specifically what I think is really nuanced elements of this episode where we really see who the Mandalorian is as a person. There was a bit where I really love how they're like, I must warn you, when they're talking about the armor, it will draw many eyes.
Yeah.
So that tells me so much in just one sentence that A, it's not necessarily that the Mandalorians want to be seen. B, that it's kind of funny because it's going to be quite ostentatious. And C, that someone might want to steal that armor because it's going to draw many eyes and people are probably going to want to grab it off him. So I thought that was really cute, but I also thought these like distinct human elements and humility in his character that I'm starting to see. And I think the main scene that really brought that out for me was where the four stormtroopers are going to shoot him and he releases those darts from his wrist. The writing could have been that he just kind of walks forward and looks really badass after he's done that. But what he essentially does is looks around to make sure that they're dead. And even that little tiny bit just gives a much more vulnerable aspect to his character, a much more real aspect to his character of what you would do in that situation, making sure that your enemies are actually on the ground dead.
Yeah, absolutely. I think what's interesting too, just, I know you've got the list of things you'll go through. I thought what was really cool is that, so they establish that there's a couple of different codes.
Mm-hmm.
In there. There's the guild, the Assassin's Guild code, there's the Mandalorian code, and then there's also that he's cultivating his own code. And I thought it was really interesting, you know, particularly the fundamental aspect of this episode is that after turning in Baby Yoda, he decides that he can't just leave it to whatever they're going to do to him because he thinks it's going to be pretty bad. And it reminds me of that that quote. I think it's from maybe one of our previous governor generals, or it's like a former general who I became governor general in Australia, or one of the defense chiefs, and it's that. The standard that you walk past is the standard that you accept. And so the fact that he knew that what they were doing, if he just allowed it, that meant that he is someone that accepts that that's okay to do. And he really kind of struggles with, you know, both the code that he accepted in terms of being an assassin, the guild code, but then also that Mandalorian code then coming in around protecting their own. And what's interesting... just quickly is so in the really expanded the universe, which I think is now called Legends, the Mandalorian warrior culture, they're not a race of people, they're a culture. And what that means is they're a lot more open to accepting children and other members if they are part of their culture rather than if they are part of their nationality or race or whatever you kind of want to group it.
This is the way.
It's the way.
As long as you follow the way, which sounds very Buddhist.
Yeah. I like how they kind of grab onto that. But what else was kind of standing out for you in this episode?
I really loved the armor of the female Mandalorian.
Oh, yeah.
I loved his armor. I loved his new and improved shiny spicy armor, I think they called it. It's very spicy.
You called it.
Remember how I said spicy and you were spicy. Anyway, you seem to have forgotten that. And I loved the Viking kind of fur that was on her and making it a little bit different from the average Mandalorian, and that she's someone special, because I'm really loving, aside from the steel of the Mandalorian armor, I'm loving the mixture of native elements in there. It's really bringing, a realistic approach to the planet, to the world, in that there's elements of nature or animalistic primal stuff. So you've got, I mean, fur comes from an animal. So you've got that thing of hunting, prey, killing, predator, that sort of stuff, aside from the cold steel of the technology and the armor and stuff. And I love that mix. It's really making it a lot that more primal, three-dimensional for me.
Well, she does say that as well. That's quite interesting that when you get this armor, you are both... that Mandalorians are both hunter and prey.
Yeah. And I definitely feel that the music is really touching that tribal element and getting those wind chimes. And we've actually done a little bit more of a look into the music. And so we'll be doing a video on that soon. And I think his name's Ludwig Göransson. But basically, he locked himself in a room for many, many months and just started playing those instruments himself. So those... wind flutes and everything that you're hearing with the drum beats and stuff, that's essentially him.
Yeah.
Just working through how each individual theme is going to go. So we're going to love talking about that. Well, I will. Hopefully you'll be okay with it as well. That thing, the music was really good. I thought the color scheme, you know, I love the color stuff. I thought that was really good. A lot more. And I don't know if it was because we'd watched it on a bit more of a higher definition.
Yeah. Maybe the ones that we were watching through an unspoken means that they were lower quality. But I think that the show was a lot more enjoyable in a higher definition. Yeah. So,
more
you
detail.
You feel more ingrained in the actual scene.
Yeah. I think there's just so much attention paid to detail in this show that I'm really loving. I recall that at the very beginning of the episode, just seeing the fur, the little baby tufts of fur highlighted by the sunlight on the head of Yoda.
Baby Yoda.
Baby Yoda. I assume he's not actually Yoda.
Well, we can talk about that later.
And the green of him, the aqua green of him, is so contrasting against everything else in the landscape. It's really giving that... impetus of Baby Yoda somehow being important, Baby Yoda signifying change, signifying life against an otherwise stagnant landscape. Yes, and being foreign and something potentially representing upheaval for the Mandalorian himself and possibly society as a whole. So there's so many aspects of this that's going to be really good to pick apart, and the Easter eggs and everything, once we've ventured further through the series.
Yeah.
But I'm really just enjoying where it's going. And I love how it's, again, it's that realism and that understanding of the audience and people as a whole that I'm really enjoying. And this could have been particularly picked up in this episode because of Deborah Chow directing this episode. I don't know how much of an influence the director has in terms of what they're actually representing throughout the show, whether they have like specific veins that they have to kind of steer along and keep quite straight to, or whether they bring their own little sense of something. But I loved at the end of this with the jetpacks and stuff.
Yeah, I was going to say, what did you think of all the Mandalorians kind of coming to his rescue?
Yeah, I thought that was really great. And I love how when they just say to each other, this is the way, this is the way, it's essentially saying thank you. You understand it immediately. And even when the Mandalorian Din is in the in his ship and the guy comes by and just sort of like gives him the thumbs up and then heads off on those jetpacks. Immediately, I'm like, oh, that's awesome. I'd want one of those. And then the Mandalorian says to himself,
I've got to get one of those.
You know, it's just very real.
Because you know, that was the guy that came up and saluted him was the guy that he fought with.
Yeah.
When he's initially, coming in with the Beskar Steel. So I think it's kind of showing that, you know, that brotherhood or that binding of the culture is way more important than their personal fights. It's almost like, you know, so we have it in Australia with, let's say, our cousins in New Zealand, where we say we're the best of friends and worst of enemies. But, you know, so it's like they're allowed to fight among each other, but no one else is allowed to touch him.
Yeah, and I think the idea of him saying, I've got to get one of those, indicates that this isn't, you know, there's some fun parts to being a Mandalorian as well. And he's not, like, so far gone that... being like, it's almost like when you think about a defense force personnel or something, and there's a lot of training involved. There's a lot of making sure that you're part of the machine and that you don't show much emotion. But also, it's really cool to be flying those really fast jets and being able to press those buttons. And I think that it's going to be enjoyable just having that aspect of it stay true, that he's not so far gone that he's taking this type of fun stuff for granted.
Yeah.
And it's quite enjoyable as a person being elevated to that kind of status and being able to play with those toys that are weapons.
And I think it's quite realistic too, given that they, quite underground, that he doesn't have the full complement of Mandalorian things. So he's only just gotten his full Beskar Steel armor now. Most Mandalorians don't have it.
Well,
I don't think it's maybe not that. I think what they're doing is they're showing that there's variability. So they're not a military that's outfitted the same way that the stormtroopers are. And what I mean is all the stormtroopers have the same armor, the same weapons, you know, the same tactical gear.
Mandalorians are based on merit.
Yeah, well, and they're like, it's almost like war parties. And so, you know, you get either what you buy, what you steal, what you make. And now, more particularly because they are underground, you know, you're doing bounty contracts and, you know, whatever money you get, you will improve your own stuff. But it's a lot of variability between each Mandalorian. And I think that was really good to show that, yes, some of them have those jetpacks and wow, they made a huge difference. But he doesn't have one of those. But he has those awesome guns that essentially, you know, he'll shoot you in your toe and it'll just like obliterate you. But we haven't seen anyone else with that, so...
Absolutely. And I had hoped to see Cara Dune in this episode. We may have seen her, but I couldn't be sure whether we had seen her in that big heavy infantry
group.
Well, all of them were there.
I don't know. I think the reason why I don't think it was her is because they've said that the Mandalorians don't take off their helmets. And so when we've seen in the trailer, we do see her face.
True.
So I think when he's now on the run... next stop, I think he's gonna.
She might be a different.
Start getting a posse.
So we didn't get to see Cara, which I'm a bit sad about, but hopefully it'll be a big build up to when they finally meet her. And I enjoyed the montage that we get of his background and a little bit more of a fulsome understanding or complete understanding of where he's come from.
Yeah.
And also, like, it kind of gives a potential understanding of why it is that he feels a kinship with Baby Yoda.
Yeah.
In that Baby Yoda's very vulnerable in a situation where he's potentially going to get killed or is wanted for something. And even though we don't really know what Din was more of a, not necessarily wanted or precious or a special snowflake or anything, but he was in a very similar situation, and it seems as if his parents unfortunately have perished in that situation, but he's been saved.
Yeah, alone in the world.
That's why he's come forward. So I think that's really great in showing that relationship building for him and Yoda together, and how he's kind of seen the parallels in himself, whether he realizes it consciously or not. Just really great episode.
Yeah. Interesting as well. I was going to say, we spoke the other night about some speculations on who Baby Yoda is. Mm. Do you have any thoughts at this stage?
Well, I don't think he's actually Yoda. I think we call him Baby Yoda, but I think potentially... it's interesting because I thought when Baby Yoda's first given up to that pack of scientists or whoever was giving the Mandalorian the bounty for it, they said, oh, it's healthy. So what that tells me is this isn't only one of that species. It tells me that these guys are very aware of that species and they're able to distinguish whether this is a healthy Yoda or not.
I didn't make that joke. I thought that was just, that thing was just doing it like its vital signs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because in that universe, that species is very, very rare. So we've only seen two of them.
Sure. So I'm getting the feeling you actually want to tell us.
So I've got some speculations.
It's funny how you ask that. Because if you have a theory, just say it rather than asking me if I have a theory.
So my speculations, it's kind of twofold. Well, there's a couple. So one is that people have been speculating that this may be a clone of Yoda. And the reason being is that scientists... that's very interested, and he was actually wanting to protect Baby Yoda and keep it alive. He has a patch that is aligned to the Kamino cloners, and so that's one of the things. And we know that in the expanded universe, or now it's considered legends, that the Empire was very focused on creating clones, and you know the fact that they came to power as the Empire with clone troopers, you know, that's just kind of a carry on theme. The other part is that when you speculate that, you know, Baby Yoda is roughly about 50 years old, now when you go back what happened about 50 years before, that was roughly what would have been the birth of Anakin Skywalker, who was, you know, considered to be conceived from the Force and the Chosen One. People are speculating because Baby Yoda is already so naturally adept at using the Force in a very strong way, similar to Yoda, that this Baby Yoda might actually be the true Chosen One. And so that they're actually rewriting how that prophecy is actually meant to end.
So rather than Anakin being the true Chosen One, we're thinking that Baby Yoda was that all the time.
Potentially.
Well,
potentially.
That's a very interesting theory.
Yeah, otherwise it can just be that, you know, adding additional sprouts onto other prophecies that, yes, Anakin was conceived of the Force, and when now I'm really kind of geeking out, but when Darth Sidious and his master Darth Plagueis were trying to birth or bring into being a Force user, that they thought it was Anakin, but that they could have brought into Yoda, or they could have brought Anakin, and the light side of the Force's response was to bring in Baby Yoda. So we don't know. There's a lot of other things at play that can kind of be built out.
Yeah, really interesting. It's just going to be really fun to see where this one goes.
But yeah, absolutely. I think this is definitely for mine the best episode to date. I thought it was a lot more adult in the way that it was presented. I thought the music was a lot more on point. We got rid of some of the cheesy triumph music that Disney had kind of brought about. And it was a lot more cohesive and engaging episode.
Yeah, epic, complete.
Yeah.
Everything that we kind of had expected from the first couple. Yeah. It was just a run-up.
And a lot of action. So, you know, I think a comment was too that I was a little bit concerned about the pacing of the first two episodes, that, you know, it didn't feel like a lot was happening or not a lot of significant things. But this one really stepped it up. So
yeah, I agree. And it makes me feel as if we can trust the people behind The Mandalorian, because I think they've probably deliberately made those very runner-up episodes so that we can really feel the impact of episode 3. And I certainly feel the impact.
Just supports my rule of three with having to watch 3 episodes before you. Well, that's 3 from 3.
All right.
All right, guys, let us know what you think in the comments below. While you're there, hit like.
Hit subscribe.
And we'll see you next time.
Bye.